Okay, can you see my slides now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is just an overview of mucormycosis, and some of the points I am telling here might be already known to you, but the next two sessions may be really helpful if you have an overview of what is happening in the field of mucormycosis. Is something we have already learned in our undergraduate and postgraduates, and some of us might have already seen cases also during our training. So I should say, I extend my gratitude and thanks for this opportunity. And we must understand this letter dated 19th May 2021 from the Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has not given us the information that mucormycosis is a notifiable disease under Epidemic Diseases Act 1897. And we need to follow the treatment guidelines. It is there already in the national as well as our state medical guidelines are there. So we need to follow these guidelines in managing these patients. And the prompt recognition and treatment is very much important in saving the lives of these patients, because this is a disease with high mortality. So this is something I would like to emphasize, and it says the importance of this webinar or this session that the district committee of IMA is organizing today. And we know that this is something has started in December 2019 as COVID-19, and it has reached the proportion of a pandemic. We have gone through the wave one, that as they say, and now we are at the second wave. But from the what we had in last year and what we are facing today, there are different perspectives of the problem as such. We are facing new challenges. We know that the younger age group is getting affected. Pregnant females are getting admitted in ICUs, and there is, as more people from the youngsters are getting admitted into ICU, obviously that also will be including these people who are actually the hardworking potential people of the society. So this is a real tragedy that is happening and we are all facing today, and mortality is higher. This may not be the actual mortality, but as the number of cases are increasing, obviously the proportionate mortality will make us our ICU facility a major challenge. And we have all started learning a lot about oxygen, not about oxygen use, how to connect it, how to store it, even how to transport it. So this was something this outbreak has taught us. And about ventilators, almost all of us are more familiar with NRBM, NIV and other ventilator uses. And we have been managing to some extent. Now we have, again, new challenges in the form of mucormycosis, and it is commonly known as black fungus, but it's a misnomer. It is not actually the black fungus. The black fungus is Staphylococcus niger because of the melanin in its wall, but this is mucormycosis that they are all commonly describing as black fungus in the media. COVID-19 and mucormycosis. COVID-19 is a new disease. We don't know what exactly it is even today. We are seeing more and more different types of presentations. We are seeing different problems, and we are seeing COVID-19 associated mucormycosis now. But for us, mucormycosis is a non-disease. We have been seeing this in immunocompromised patients, patients on dialysis, patients on immunosuppressive therapy, post-transplant, and especially those with diabetes mellitus. And why this is gaining so much attention? Because this is very much devastating and actually disfiguring. And I always used to feel amputation is the most painful situation, but now we see the mucormycosis patient, maybe this is the most painful situation. All on a sudden, you are getting some infection, you are asked to mutilating, disfiguring procedure. So this is very, very difficult and disappointing for the patient and relative to accept. And we know that it has got a very high mortality. And what we can do, we need to have an early clinical suspicion for early detection and early management. And we must always tell us and our others that it's a very rare human infection. It's not the routine of the world. You don't have to, or we don't have to be so much worried or anxious about it. And there is no human to human transmission of this. But we know that this mycorrhizae are ubiquitous in nature. It can be found in devastating vegetation, soil, and it's there everywhere in the environment. Seems it's there everywhere. All of us are exposed to this spores every day. and it grow rapidly and release large number of spores, and that can become airborne, and that is the way it is coming to the patients or people, those who are at risk of getting this infection. It belongs to the order Mucorales, and the genera Rhizopus mucor and Rhizomucor are there, and there are some more in this order and the genera, and this is causing the disease what is known as mucormycosis. The two important ones we always hear about is one is mucormycosis and the other is Aspergillus. And this, by the examination, they can clearly say that because the hyphae of Mucorales are actually different from the hyphae of Aspergillus, so there will be a, it is easy to tell whether the if we have a clear specimen and pathological opinion, we'd be able to say that this is actually the mucormycosis or the Aspergillus that is being affected in this patient, and which treatment we have to decide for that particular patient. And we know that it's an airborne infection. It is, the spores are everywhere in the environment, and it gets through the nasal turbinates up to the alveoli. And the other important feature about this mucormycosis is it's an angio-invasive fungus. That means it is causing invasion of the vasculature by hyphae, and it is causing necrosis or damage to the tissue that we need to remove the tissue to get the patient, get the antifungal to the patient, and if the patient has to get in recovery, we actually we have to remove the necrosis or the eschar or the dead tissue that is happening in this patient because of the angioinfarction. Angioinvasion. Infarction, necrosis of infected tissue, that is a hallmark of invasive disease, and that is causing the so much of frightening videos and images because of this sort of this black scar that is happening and that we need to remove if you really want to come up with a recovery for this patient. And why it is called black fungus? Because of the frightening black color that is due to the tissue necrosis caused by the fungus. So what are the risk factors? We all know this, but I'm just listing it again. Diabetes mellitus, especially diabetic ketoacidosis, hematological malignancies, hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, solid organ transplantation, immunosuppression, especially drugs like steroids, HIV/AIDS. We know that we have been taught a steroid as double-edged sword. So we need to know when to start steroids. We know that when the patient has got saturation drop, only at that point when the patient needs initiation of steroid, and not only any patient when diagnosed with COVID-19, and the drugs should never be given as an over-the-counter prescription, especially in this context of mucormycosis. And we now know that COVID-19 itself, it comes as a risk factor for mucormycosis. So all the listed one, diabetes, diabetic ketoacidosis, low immunity, and all sorts of things are happening in a COVID-19 patient. But now we have to believe, because there are people who are not diabetic, who don't have anything, even before they become, they have not come to the ICU, they have not come to the ventilator, still they are developing mucormycosis. So whether the COVID-19 itself is causing a predisposition or is it a risk factor for mucormycosis, we have to think clearly and loudly. Iron overload and treatment with deferoxamine, these are all already listed risk factors. So we have to be careful, and trauma and burns. In the beginning, there was a comment about the steam inhalation. We know that when there is a mucosal injury, when there is a local injury, there's a high risk factor. It's already listed. But we cannot say that this is the risk factor in this patient, because we have, as clinicians of modern medicine, we need to have more to say. But it could be a risk factor with the available knowledge that we have. And earlier, diabetes was, mucormycosis was described as a diabetes defining illness, and now we say at CAM, that is COVID-associated mucormycosis. Another important point we must always remember, our inadvertent use of antibiotic, especially azithromycin and sorts of things, are really giving a platform for these fungus to flourish. And we also know that prior voriconazole therapy, for some other reason, is actually a risk factor for developing, or it's considered as an independent risk factor for development of mucormycosis. Because when we are treating for an invasive aspergillosis, there is a re-emergence of another rare fungi, and that is how the mucor comes into the play when the aspergillosis we are giving treatment with voriconazole. So voriconazole is actually listed as a treatment or high risk factor, independent risk factor for development of mucormycosis. Diabetes mellitus, in the situation of COVID-19, we know that COVID-19 has got its own effects on beta cells of pancreas, and there is an about 4% or so risk of future development of diabetes if a person develops COVID-19 infection. We know that COVID-19 itself produces an insulin resistant state. And we also know that the moment the patient comes to the ICU, patient is so much worried, anxious, and asking to use the pulse oximeter, start, they get the tachycardia, they get the, all the sympathetic overactivity, and all this contribute to the development of high sugars, because all the counter regulatory hormones of insulin is in play. And so we know that being into the ICU itself makes the patient so much worried and anxious, and they think that they are going to be into a ventilator and they are going to die very soon. So that sort of scenario is there. So we need to give a lot of psychosocial support for these people in ICU. And we have our own challenges, our own problems in diabetes management, because we know that COVID area or COVID ICU, we have to have with the proper infection control practices. We need to get the blood glucose. The continuity of care, we have to ensure, though there are shifts of 6 hours or 8 hours in most of the hospitals for ICU. So we have to address all those things. And other drugs used in COVID-19 infection, as I have already listed, especially steroid, tocilizumab, and baricitinib and tofacitinib, that might be coming into play, or some of the places have used some of these drugs. So these are all risk factors for COVID-19 associated mucormycosis. Another important point I would like to emphasize, mucormycosis, mucovale, they thrive in high glucose. They favor acidic condition, diabetic ketoacidosis. So we should be very keen to control this blood glucose and avoid development of diabetic ketoacidosis, especially the patients are in isolation or in quarantine. They should be emphasized to monitor. Otherwise, all the patients getting admitted are coming with 400, 500 or very high blood glucose. That is not a very good scenario, because we are seeing more number of mucormycosis cases now. Why this is happening in hyperglycemia and diabetic ketoacidosis? Because this has got an enzyme called ketone reductase, and it allows to thrive the fungus in high glucose and acidic conditions like diabetic ketoacidosis. Other important point may not be very important to us at this point, because deferoxamine and iron overload. If a person has got iron overload, the fungus enjoys eating this free iron. So diabetic ketoacidosis also causing an elevated milieu of free iron. So this enhances fungal growth, tissue invasion. So this also has to be kept in our mind. And at this point, there are papers which say that high dose of zinc also behaves almost similarly, because zinc also, with depletion of zinc, the fungal growth is decreased. But if there is a zinc in plenty, the fungus favors the growth. And that is also, so we have to be very careful in administering drugs unnecessarily. The patient should have a balanced diet and relax period during the isolation or quarantine, then starting all sorts of vitamins and other things. So we don't know, many of the things might be useful or may not be useful. This classification I don't have to emphasize: rhino-orbitocerebral, pulmonary, cutaneous, gastrointestinal, and disseminated. When to suspect? The spores enter to the paranasal sinuses of a susceptible host, and we know that the presentations are very clear. It could be something like an acute sinusitis. It could be something like fever, nasal congestion, nasal discharge, bloody discharge from the nose, headache, proptosis, periorbital edema. And in patients with cerebral mucormycosis, it could be obtundation, cranial nerve palsies. And in pulmonary, we know that hemoptysis, pneumonia, hematemesis, and DI, it could be bowel infarction or bleed. And direct inoculation can come as skin lesion. But in diabetes, the predominant form is rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, and in other hematological malignancies and all, it's usually pulmonary or disseminated mucormycosis. And we know that it can affect palate, orbit, and brain, so we should be examining the patient for eye pain, nasal septum turners, open the mouth and see whether there is an eschar, whether there is a difficulty in eye movements, whether the pupils are normal. Some of them, even in challenged situations of COVID, we must be able to do, or we must be trying to do, so that we can detect this patient early. These are some of the pictures. This is the black eschar. I am indebted to Dr. Suma for giving all the pictures. This is the black eschar. This is the typical presentation with the periorbital puffiness, redness, and this is another patient, and we must identify this sort of plaque scar. So if it is there, it is mucor, and we need to start intervention very fast and very rapidly. So what we should do for our patient? There is no need to panic. We must emphasize again and again, this is not a new disease. This is a known disease. We all know the disease. It's not like COVID-19. We know the disease, what it's causing, what is the mortality, what is the treatment. Everything we know, and that we are equipped with the knowledge. So we need to start it, and we need to initiate it early so that the public should not panic about the situation. Because this is not like COVID-19 where we don't know how to treat these patients. There is no human to human spread. We need to have a good control of diabetes. We should encourage our patient not to use over-the-counter drugs, especially antibiotics, antifungal, as well as steroids. And if there is any of these symptoms, they should get an early opinion from the healthcare facility. And we know that there is a virus, there's the host, the immune system, and the environment. There are a lot of speculations about oxygen, industrial oxygen, humidifier, water used in humidifier, and about zinc use, and many other things. Initially we have heard this steam inhalation, we don't know, but we should protect the immune system, and we should make every effort to control whatever is possible. Mask use, many things are there, but definitely it will happen only if the person's host immune system is affected, and maybe COVID-19 itself is causing this as a cause. And one more point I would like to say, pulmonary infection, we know that there are specific indicators how it is happening. And we know that these assays, galactomannan assay, 1,3 beta D glucan assay, this is all seen in predominantly aspergillosis. And if it is actually normal, it is unlikely to be aspergillosis, and it is more likely to be mucormycosis. This is also one point we should be remembering. And we know that I have already said pulmonary mucormycosis, a risk factor prior for ritonavir prophylaxis. So there is no role for antifungal, prophylactic use of antifungal in mucormycosis. So we need to identify it early and treat it early. And we must understand that what we need is a clinical correlation, high index of clinical suspicion and clinical correlation, because this is a common contaminant in cultures. So just because we get a mucor in the culture, we cannot say that it is mucor. It has to be clinically correlated and collaborated. But we must also understand that early suspicion, we need to start treatment. Early surgical debridement of immunosuppression, antifungal therapy, elimination of predisposing factors, and optimize underlying medical conditions. So this is what is going to be discussed by the coming sessions by Dr. Suma and Dr. Fairoz. And I have just given an overview of what is this condition, what we should be knowing, and what we should be doing. And we must think of this entity in appropriate clinical setting, and we must have an early diagnosis and early treatment. Also, we must avoid all the predisposing factors, especially control of diabetes and optimization of blood glucose. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Chandri ma'am, for that wonderful overview, almost a very comprehensive coverage, I would say, and a full framework has been done on which any area can be built on. That's how you made the framework. Wonderful, ma'am. Wonderful. The question answer session can be at the end of after all the three speakers, or can you wait till then, ma'am?
Okay.
Wait, yeah. Okay. So shall we go ahead with the second talk of the day?
Yes, we can.
Okay. And it is a very rare opportunity we get here. Cheshida talk kazhinja Anyathiyude talk kekkanulla oru rare opportunity aanu. Another doyen speaking from the same family, I would say, again from Calicut Medical College. An alumni of Calicut Medical College, I would say. She is none other than Dr. Suma Chandri ma'am and Anyathiyana, and she is now the additional professor of Medical College Manjeri, Department of ENT. She is also an alumni of Medical College Calicut, and she's done her MS in ENT from the Medical College of Mysore in Karnataka. She's had an experience of teaching experience of more than 21 years. She's been a DNB examiner, and she has plenty of gold medals to her credit, and she's been actively involved in the training part of National Program of Control of Deafness, then the cochlear implant program of our state government. She has more than 25 publications to her credit. She's presentations at national and international levels, gold medals and whatnot. At the organizational level, she's been the president of the Malabar chapter of Association of Otolaryngologists of India. She's been the president of the Calicut chapter, and she's been the organizing secretary and chairman of various conferences, I would say, life surgical workshops. She's been the hands-on trainer of life surgical workshops, and I don't know what else to talk about her. And I'm proud to say that she's a good friend of mine too. And we are, I would say, corresponding batches. I'm the same batch from Trivandrum Medical College. So I proudly invite Dr. Suma to talk on the ENT aspects of mucormycosis today. Dr. Suma?
Yeah. Thank you, Asha, for the wonderful description that you have given. I don't know what all you added.
I didn't add anything from my own. I added everybody's perception of you.
Okay. Shall I share the screen?
Yes.
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
Good evening, all. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of IMA Malappuram District, especially Dr. Jalal and Dr. Asha, for inviting me to this webinar to discuss on the much debated hot topic of today, the black fungus in COVID-19. And we know that this has emerged. We witnessed an outbreak of mucormycosis, now popularly known as black fungus, in widely circulated in the media. An emergence of, an epidemic of mucormycosis in the pandemic of COVID-19. So mucormycosis, the fungus, and the COVID-19 virus is really a deadly combination. And this has all been beautifully covered in the previous talk. So my job is made very simple. We know that this is a deadly disease. It's known for decades. So it's not a new disease at all. It's an invasive fungal disease. And we have cases even before, and we have, this is a series we have presented in Dubai in World Diabetic Congress, and later in 2013 in Melbourne. This is another study, a clinical study of fungal sinusitis in diabetic patients presenting with ophthalmology complications. So we see cases even before, but it is not as common as this. It is a rare disease, but not unknown. So what are the burning issues of this mucormycosis today? We know that the incidence is definitely on the rise over the last few decades, but it has emerged as an epidemic over the last 4 months. And we know that any fungi can be pathogenic in an immunocompromised state. So we do have an expanding spectrum. And microbiologists are of opinion that they sometimes get mixed growth. And we do have atypical presentation. So that means we need to have a high index of suspicion and awareness among the patients and the doctors as such, so that we can pick them up early enough so that the mortality can be reduced to a larger extent. And now if we are getting good results only if we get the patients early and we start the treatment early enough. So we need to have standardized treatment protocols. And we also should know why in India it has emerged as an epidemic. We know that the diabetes is very common here, but is there any other factors? We know that the primary determinant of mucormycosis is not exactly the pathogen as much as the immune status of the patient. So immunocompromised patient is a favorable host for the mucormycosis. And are there any conditions like prolonged hospital stay, the breaches in aseptic precautions, high fungal spore count in the environment? Now we are keeping fungal spores are being in our college, we are keeping the Sabraud Sagar plates in the ICU to assess whether the daily fungal spore count. And what I heard is it is not as it is not in any increase, there is no increase in the in the fungal spore count in the ICU. So we know that it is ubiquitous, it can be from anywhere, and prolonged ICU stay with invasive procedures, are there causing symptoms? We don't know. Now coming to the diagnosis, as we have already stressed in the previous session, the most important to have a early diagnosis, our patient should be aware of what all symptoms they can present with. Early symptoms are often subtle. They can be excessive dryness or excessive nasal crusting, which is also common in patients having oxygen therapy using mask. So those patients having these symptoms, we should tell the COVID, when the patients are discharged, we should tell them or make them aware regarding the red flag signs so that they can come to the hospital, get the nasal endoscopy done, and they can go reassured if there are there is anything of this sort. And numbness, very common is numbness and swelling, unilateral facial numbness or swelling of the cheek, unilateral facial pain, headache, then blood-stained brownish nasal discharge or blood-stained nasal discharge. They can have periorbital edema. So these are the early symptoms that, so very often these are symptoms that can be neglected. So I want to stress again, we need to have a high index of suspicion. The early diagnosis is very, very crucial because it spreads so rapidly. This is one of our patients from our series. This is a 10th standard student. He had gone for a picnic and from there he developed fever and blackish discoloration around the eye. And so he brought back and got admitted here in Calicut Medical College. You can see by evening, he completely lost the vision and there is complete ophthalmoplegia. And you can see he is developing the blackish necrosis of the palate. And this is another patient, a young, beautiful lady presented with the swelling of the cheek and ptosis. And facial palsy also. And she was on irregular treatment with poor glycemic control. And you can see that the complete ophthalmoplegia and total loss of vision within a day. And she later became drowsy and developed cranial nerve palsy, 3, 4, 6 already there. And then 7th nerve palsy, 9, 10, and 12 cranial nerve palsies. She was on Ryle's tube. So rapid will be the progression of the disease. This is the same patient, periorbital edema, and later he presented to us like this. So these are the common presentations already discussed. So early diagnosis is awareness among the patients and the treating physician is very important. And we all suspected cases, we should do a meticulous nasal endoscopy. So this blackish ischia, that is that you see the thick necrotic black slough or a black necrotic tissue within the nasal cavity that you see is not an early finding. The early finding is less, just pallor of the mucosa, and it usually happens because the spores enter the nasal cavity by inhalation, and when it gets the proper environment, they germinate and gets into the tissues. So early, it will develop lesions within the middle turbinate. So you can, if there is any suspicion, you can take a biopsy from that and send for examination. Don't forget to do a cranial nerve examination and examination of the oral cavity for early necrosis or blackish discoloration. So these are all late cases. Late in the sense, since it progresses very rapidly, by the time we get, these are already late. And radiology may be very unremarkable. CT, usually there is some proptosis and minimal mucosal thickening alone. So, and in about 12% of cases, CT may be normal. So the best to do in suspected cases is MRI with contrast. Most often they'll be coming with a CT, CT scan of the paranasal sinuses. So where any evidence of extra sinus invasion or focal loss of contrast enhancement is suggestive of an invasive fungal disease. So as a rule of thumb, you get more disease outside the sinus than within the sinus in invasive fungal disease. So look carefully in the pre-antral area and the retromaxillary area. Even there is intact bone. You can see, if you can compare the other side, you can see lesions developing in the retroantral area, and there is involvement of the fat in the premaxillary area. So this is very important for early diagnosis. And some cases, you can see this in T2 weighted fat suppressed images. When you do a fat suppression, the fat will not be seen hyper intense even in T2 weighted images. So in fat suppressed sequence, what is seen intense is the inflammation. So you get, in this case, it is, you can see that the entire extracorneal, intracorneal muscles, optic nerve, everything is involved. And once that happens, it can spread very easily through the superior orbital fissure. And here you can see that even the internal carotid artery is occluded. So what you have to see is, in the early case of this, look for the loss of contrast enhancement. This side you can see the contrast taking up in the middle turbinate, but this side, the middle turbinate is looking black. This is called the black turbinate sign. And you can see the hyper intensity of extending, the evidence of inflammation extending posteriorly into the infratemporal fossa. And we don't see many pulmonary cases. I inquired with the pulmonologist also, and we have not seen many cases, but this is the characteristic finding that you can see in somewhat a little more indicating mucormycosis, that you, the ground glass appearance surrounded by an area of consolidation. So this is almost we can't say diagnostic point, a pointer towards mucormycosis. So to diagnose, we should send a specimen, take a specimen from the suspected area. That is more important, more useful than sending scrapings or a swab. If you're taking a swab, send multiple swabs. But they always say that taking the tissue is more useful than taking the swab. And anything, pus or tissue, everything is, you can send, but always send a tissue which is more useful. And 10% KOH wet mount, they can give the report in 1 hour. So how do you take it? You take it in a sterile bottle. If you can send it immediately, you can even give it in a dry sterile bottle, but ideally you should put it in saline. A little saline only is required. Don't completely fill the bottle, just above the tissue. And there are, if facilities are available, calcophore white stain and immunofluorescence microscopy will, a fluorescent microscopy will give you a better diagnosis. And the next is, you have to take a biopsy wherever you are suspecting the lesion or wherever devitalized tissues are seen, and send it for histopathology examination. And they do a fungal staining also in the pathology department. And the most sensitive in identifying fungi is Gomori methylamine silver stain or GMS stain. They cannot say the fungi are negative, the specimen is negative for fungi unless we do a GMS stain. Next is fungal. These are the typical fungal hyphae that posiseptate or usually aseptate. Broad hyphae with branching at right angles. So these are very characteristic, and they'll give you the report if there is evidence of angio invasion, if there is evidence of mucosal invasion, which are suggestive of invasive fungal rhinosinusitis or invasive fungal disease. Now, fungal culture and sensitivity is, though the gold standard, it is often unrewarding due to technical reasons. So ideally we should, if we get a culture report, culture and sensitivity report, we know that we don't have many antifungals at hand. So if we get the proper report, that will be ideal to start the proper antifungal therapy and to prevent the development of resistance. And MRI, PNS with orbit
MRI PNS with plus orbit with contrast, we have already discussed. So we need to have always give gadolinium contrast, and we need to see all areas of T1 contrast and T2 fat suppressed, all sequences are to be taken. And this, I forgot to tell that this actually grow as a white cotton wool appearance. So they are not black fungus ideally. The black fungus, as already told, it is because of the angio invasion and necrosis that produce. And later it turns into a gray combination of grayish and whitish, which is known as salt and pepper appearance. So we have, this is mucor, and in contrast, the aspergillus will have thin filamentous hyphae, which is branched and with acute angulation. So what are the other blood tests that you do? We have to do CBC, ESR, C-reactive protein. This is very important when to assess the prognosis of the patient. ESR, CRP are very simple tests that can be done every day when the patient is on amphotericin therapy and or on debridement, see whether the patient is responding or not, and have a food proper assessment of diabetic status. And serum electrolytes and RFT, especially when the patient is on the amphotericin therapy, ideally after each dose, it is better to do serum electrolytes and renal function test. And serum ferritin, serum galactomannan, as already described, is a pointed towards, if it is, it's not very sensitive, but if it is, it's a pointed towards the aspergillus. And we don't have such serological tests for mucor. And then COVID status has to be assessed, and any other immunocompromised states. And we need to have a rapid diagnostic test. That is the need of the hour, because the most important thing is to diagnose them early enough. As we already told, the serum galactomannan assay and molecular methods like PCR-based approaches, and identification from the culture specimens, early identification from the culture specimens, all these are very important. And the principles of management, we do have three important things. And all these three should be started abruptly and followed up absolutely rapidly, which is very, very important. That includes prompt surgical debridement. All devitalized tissue has to be removed completely. And the extent of the surgical debridement will depend upon will be dictated by the MRI. So you have to take MRI. You may see a disease behind an intact bone. So you have to remove that bone to enter into the infected area. And rapid reversal of immunosuppression, which is very important. Persistent immunosuppression is in conditions the treatment is extremely challenging. That is the advantage of patients with diabetes. You can promptly control diabetes if the patient is admitted, and that gives a better survival chance. And systemic antifungal therapy. So all three must be started immediately and followed up. Have a close follow-up, not during the hospital stay alone. You have to have it's like a commitment from the part of the treating physician. You have to have a long duration of follow-up for these patients. And who all are involved in the treatment? I told it is a multidisciplinary approach. You should have an ENT surgeon, physician, ophthalmologist, then neurosurgeon, maxillofacial surgeon whenever required, and then for diagnosis, definitely you should have the support of microbiology, pathology, and then very often these cases may end up in mutilating surgeries. So we need to have a reconstructive surgery later. Most of the surgeries are done under endoscopy, so they won't have any problems or any disfigurement. But if it involves skin, you have to do an external approach. And sometimes you need to remove the eye. Since there are situations which is very traumatic to the patient and the treating physician, and they can be successfully reconstructed later once the whole treatment is over and you're sure that the disease has gone. It may take up to 6 months. And prompt surgical debridement, aggressive debridement of all devitalized tissue, and never compromise on that. That is why we told that you may have to decide on orbital excentration. but the indications are very less. When you have an extensive involvement of the orbital apex, that is an indication for orbital excentration. But I think it will be discussed in detail in the next top discussion, so I am not going into the details of that. But when you have an extensive orbital apex involvement, and loss of vision per se is not at all an indication for orbital excentration, because loss of vision can be due to central retinal artery occlusion also. And most often these are endoscopic and may need an external approach reconstruction at a later date. This is a patient of this series, that is in COVID season. You can see after all the black necrotic tissue is removed, the entire nasal cavity is filled with the sloughed like white avascular tissue. And we have done an endoscopic sinus surgery, did a medial maxillectomy. Medial maxillectomy, the anterior wall of the maxilla will be removed in majority of the cases, because you will have an increased access. So when you do a medial maxillectomy endoscopically, patient won't be having any disfigurement. So you can remove the they can see the posterior wall of maxilla. And if you see beyond that, then the pterygopalatine or infratemporal fossa, you have disease, you can remove the posterior wall of maxilla, or very often the posterior wall may be completely eroded. And you may have to take out the inferior medial wall of orbit. And this same patient who had an extensive involvement of the orbital periosteum also, lamina papyracea was eroded in most of the part. And this is the orbital periosteum is being debrided. You can see there is no blood at all. Usually when you debride this area by mistake, if you damage the orbital lamina papyracea, there will be bleeding, there will be fat collapse, and the orbital periosteum completely white. And you can see even after the fat coming out, there is no much bleeding. So the entire tissue has to be debrided, and you have to remove the bone to expose that area. And at times you can see erosion of the cribriform plate on either side with fungal debris adherent to the dura or into the brain parenchyma. You can see everywhere, this is the orbit is completely, the disease is completely cleared. You can see the ethmoid, sphenoid, all cleared, but there is erosion of skull base. So empirical therapy is a norm when you strongly suspect mucormycosis. You don't wait for the result to come. We'll start immediately on amphotericin. Orbit in mucormycosis will be discussed, I think, in the next. But I would like to say that when there is extensive orbital apex involvement, that is an easy access to the intracranial cavity. So always remember that recovery from neutropenia or diabetic ketoacidosis is most predictive of survival, and intracranial spread is most predictive of mortality. If the patient is having intracranial spread at presentation, even with extensive surgical management and antifungal therapy, there is a high risk of mortality even today. So the medical management, as I've already told, control of diabetes mellitus, reversal of ketoacidosis, supportive measures, and we have the drug of choice continues to be liposomal amphotericin B, because it can be given at a higher dose, 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram body weight, 10 milligram when there is intracranial involvement. And the drug-related issues are less, much less compared to amphotericin B deoxycholate. And you have amphotericin B lipid complex also, but and that also can be given in the same dose. And hope we'll be doing this since long time, so we'll be knowing how to give liposomal amphotericin B. We have to give a test dose, about 0.25 milligram to be mixed in 100 ml saline, and you can infuse it in 30 minutes. And don't forget to pre-hydrate the patient. All patients should be pre-hydrated before starting conventional or liposomal amphotericin. And you can give 500 ml normal saline. And if the patient is having hypokalemia already, you can even add potassium chloride in that. and the therapeutic dose has to be given in 5 to 10 milligram. Usually we start in 3 to 5, ideally 5 milligram per kilogram body weight in 500 ml of 5% dextrose as a single dose over 3 hours, and the bottle has to be covered because otherwise the tissue potency will, the drug potency will be lost. And post hydrate 500 ml normal saline over 30 minutes and look for electrolytes and renal function tests. And medical management, the drugs, other drugs available are posaconazole and isavuconazole. And if the patient has given amphotericin for about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and if you feel that the patient's symptoms are improved, endoscopy is better, and there is normalization of ESR and C-reactive protein, you can discharge them on posaconazole, isavuconazole, which is good for step down therapy and for also salvage therapy. And mucorales are intrinsically resistant to other azoles, triazoles or canakantins. Posaconazole, we were having it as syrup initially, but it's now it's not preferred because it the absorption is not predictable. And because of that itself, and you have to give it with fat-rich food, because of the poor absorption itself, there are reports of breakthrough mucormycosis in patients with on posaconazole syrup. Now, extended-release tablets are available, which can be given as 300 milligram BD for 24 hours, followed by 300 milligram OD. And isavuconazole is literature in some part of the country, it is given as a first line even. And it is very costly, but 200 milligram 3 times a day for 48 hours, followed by 200 milligram daily. And the side effects are relatively less. And adjuvant therapy, we have hyperbaric oxygen. I don't have any experience, and we don't know how. There are definite reports are not available, but there are some papers say that it has got good effects. But this granulocyte colony stimulating factor in persistent neutropenia in patients with invasive fungal disease is very, very useful. And I have given for a primary immunodeficiency patient with skull-based osteomyelitis, fungal osteomyelitis, and cytokines like gamma interferon, iron chelators. Apart from desferoxamine, the other iron chelators are useful as an adjuvant therapy. And always remember that all sinusitis are not mucormycosis, and there is an unnecessary scare or panic among the public. And we know how to deal with this case. It's not a new disease, even though its mortality is unless properly managed, we do have an early pickup of cases, the mortality is not good, it's bad. You need to have a good diabetic control, judicious use of steroids only as per guidelines. Never neglect diabetic management. All these have already discussed. Awareness of early symptoms and prompt medical help. And particular caution should be given in immunocompromised patient. But since there is an increasing incidence in India particularly, we need to see other factors also. And the future lies in early diagnosis. Always the early diagnosis is the key in to have a better outcome. So if you have a therapeutic or prognostic markers or like something for mucormycosis, and we need to have functional imaging so that we can pick them up early. Non-cultural serological or PCR based assays. And we need to have combination therapy with newer antifungals so that we don't develop the resistant strains, resistant fungi. And prospective randomized controlled trials are required. To conclude, invasive fungal disease, we know the incidence is increasing. Now we have an outbreak. And the pattern of involvement is changing. And early diagnosis and prompt aggressive management is critical for successful outcome. And the absolute best predictor for success is reversal of neutropenia or diabetic ketoacidosis. And prophylactic strategies require further study. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Suma. We have heard it from the expert. It is her area of interest, fungal sinusitis and skull-based surgeries. And in fact, today she was in the news for the very challenging surgery from Manjeri Medical College, right? So we had the apt person to discuss the diagnosis and the surgical management of mucormycosis. Thank you very much, Ma. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's a very wonderful talk. I think the discussion we'll have after the third talk too. Okay, you can wait, right?
Yeah.
Thank you. Chandri ma'am had requested that she would like to leave a little early. So can Dr. Fairuz excuse us and give us maybe 5 minutes for a discussion, one or two questions with Chandri ma'am?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you for bearing with us. Thank you. So let us have one or two questions with Chandri ma'am. Chandri ma'am, you are here, right?
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. There's one question that says, does prior ivermectin predispose to this condition?
We don't know. We have no data with regard to that, and I don't know. Maybe we have to see whether it has brought any effect.
Another innocent sounding question. Why does it affect the face always?
Why does it affect the
face always?
It's a diabetic patient. It's usually seen in the face, and maybe the spores go through the mucous sinuses and then by the airborne. That may be the reason. It's an easy way. I don't know. That is what I believe.
All speculation questions, ma'am. And why is there more muco post-COVID than aspergillosis?
It's why mucor in more.
Mucor is more than aspergillus.
That also we may have to see why it is so. I don't know. Maybe the same mechanism as we see in diabetes and other things. But we have to see whether there are more number of aspergillosis. We have to wait. What is the actual situation?
Another question which came up in last day's ENT discussion also. Is there any chance that the swabs used to take the testing are infected with the fungal spores? And multiple swabbing, does it traumatize the mucosa and cause increased incidence?
Any injury in skin or mucosa, especially to skin, has shown that there is a risk. But I don't know whether we can propose it as a mechanism. Because it's seen only in those people who are actually immunosuppressed. Because we take swabs a lot. Maybe it is injuring the mucosa, that is obvious, as we discussed in the same inhalation and other things. But I don't know whether we can. Yeah, these are all hypotheses. We need to wait whether it is actually causing. Maybe or may not.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question, both to Suma ma'am and Chandri ma'am, I think. At this point of time, from a public health point of view, what can be an adequately sensitive case definition for a suspected case of mucormycosis, which can be identified by a paramedical or ASHA worker in a community, so that an early diagnosis or reduction in morbidity and mortality can be made?
One thing is, in a person who is having all other risk factors like diabetes and other things, and if the patient says something like, that of an acute sinusitis, a patient has difficulty in eye movement, eye pain, which is persisting, we have to be cautious and we need to do more investigations. But disseminated, we may not be able to pick up on. The only thing that we can pick up is this. The other one is persistent fever in a post-COVID or a person recovering from COVID. We have to think of this situation, especially in pulmonary mucormycosis.
Thank you. And on an average, how many of them were diabetic? Manjeri and Calicut, major centers, maximum number of cases. How many would you say were diabetic?
Maybe around 50%. And one patient was diabetic, but not COVID also in our case. So, but one thing we must be, that patient do not have diabetes is also coming with, just because they have COVID-19 or they have treated for COVID-19. Those cases are also being slowly getting reported. So maybe COVID-19 itself is a risk factor for this sort of immunosuppressed stage we have.
Can Suma to add to that? In your series also 50% would be diabetic or more than that?
All of them except one are diabetic. Even otherwise, diabetes is a major problem in mucormycosis, major predisposing factor.
But most of them
are usually aspergillosis, we say invasive aspergillosis.
Aspergillus?
Invasive in neutropenic patients, but in diabetics, this is the major risk factor, even otherwise, not in COVID era, even otherwise.
Another Another point is to Chandri ma'am is nephrotic syndrome, organ transplantation, rheumatology, bronchial asthma, steroids are used in plenty, but mucormycosis is not reported. Is it due to the thrombosis or the feeding artery to the area? That was another article which was being circulated. Yes.
It is seen in immunosuppressed stage. All these are listed are risk factors for mucormycosis. But I don't think we have used so much of steroids in the past. We have been prescribing steroids for every patient in requiring oxygen in the ICUs or hospitals for COVID. But thrombosis might be an explanation because the pictures we are not seeing, but the pictures that are being circulated have extensive necrotic tissue. But this is actually explained by the angioinvasion of mucormycosis also. But the case number is increasing. That is definite.
An approximate idea of the cost of treatment and how long the treatment would be needed.
Maybe 3 to 5 lakhs, I think. It's a very costly. 50 milligram is 3,000 rupees. So this 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram, one dose itself will be about that 15,000 to 20,000 per day. So it's a very expensive treatment.
Duration?
4 to 6 weeks, or depending upon the recovery, then patient has to go for the oral posaconazole or whatever it is. So it's a very expensive treatment, the whole thing.
The next question is on the oxygen concentrators. The news.
And hyperbaric oxygen is actually included as a treatment for mucormycosis. Okay, so we don't know. I can't say a correct answer with regard to oxygen.
Oxygen cylinders and everything, all possible things.
Yeah. Humidifier, methylene blue, and all those things are being circulated. But with all observations or hypothesis, we have to wait. But one thing is sure, patients are connected to humidifier, they should follow all the infection control practices, which we must emphasize, whether it's for mucor or otherwise. But it's said that mucus spores are everywhere. So it's host immunity is that matters more than the other things.
Yellow fungus now, colors are coming in.
I think it's the Aspergillus and white fungus. And there was some notes also I have read. It's better not to call them with the color than actually say what it is. Because it might be confusing for everyone.
And what species of the mucorail was seen in the current epidemic?
I'm not sure. Maybe Dr. Suma will be able to answer.
Suma will be better.
Rhizopus is more common before COVID era. The most common among the mucorails. But this we did not do the species identification actually. Because they say that it has to grow in culture. The culture reports have not yet ready. They wait till... So culture insensitivity is often not very rewarding in most of the centers. So we can't say exactly which is, but most often it is rhizopus. And in some, we got a combination also. Like Aspergillus, they're also trying. Initially, they saw some growth of Aspergillus also, but we don't can't say for sure. In that patient, we sent for serum galactomannan, and that was negative. So it's unlikely.
Another question was majority are post-COVID, right? In a study from Thrissur Center, they said about from the 10, maybe 6 or 7 were not no history of COVID. But they have not done antibody. And your centers, is antibody being done?
Are sending for antibody for those who are all are COVID or post-COVID. Now,
all are post-COVID.
Two of them are even RAT positive, highly positive case. The rest, one is RT-PCR positive, and the rest two are post-COVID.
Same scenario with Chandri, ma'am?
I think there also, but we have patients who didn't have COVID, only diabetes. But otherwise, it's all COVID related.
Another question is with the association with N95 higher reuse? Is there an increased incidence?
The masks, there are studies, but not with mucor and hospital linen. All hospital linen has been shown to be associated with mucormycosis. Mask with other bacterial infections and fungal, but not definitely with mucor. But it's always better to use the standard protocol of mask use. When it is soiled or when it is wet, it is they have to change it, and it should be clean.
Nasal steroid spray, any predisposition to mucor?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
I think that should be with Suma.
Unlikely, because it is the systemic bioavailability is very, very, very less. So there, it doesn't cause any immunosuppression. So we, what in COVID also, what we tell them usually is to continue nasal steroid, because they'll be having a lot of problems if they stop in allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, or those with nasal allergy, if they stop, they'll have problems related to allergic rhinobronchial allergy. So we usually ask them to continue it, because there is nasal immunity is unlikely to be affected by continuing nasal steroids. That too, fluticasone, furoate, and mometasone, these two are usually prescribed and they have the least bioavailability.
Thank you, ma'am. I think we have been keeping Fairuz ma'am quite some time, and we'll wind up the session with Chandri ma'am. Suma ma'am, Suma, if you can remain back, we'll have a few more questions at the end. Thank you, ma'am. Chandri ma'am, for being with us at the time, and for very, very experienced sharing for all the viewers here. It was 300 to start with, and many had expressed that they couldn't join. A YouTube link and recording will be sent later for them. Many were dissatisfied that they couldn't join because a limit had crossed.
Thank you, Chandra.
Now we'll have the ophthalmic session by Dr. Fairuz. Can I introduce Fairuz ma'am to the crowd now? She's a specialist in ophthalmic plastic surgery, orbit and ocular oncology from Bangalore. She's the founder director of Horus. I suppose I'm pronouncing it right. It's Horus, right?
Yes.
Yes. Horus Specialty Eye Care. The unique concept of one-stop specialty eye care in eye plastic surgery and eye cancer. She's a native of Kannur, and she's had her MBBS from the Thrissur Medical College and an MSO in ophthalmology from Mysore Medical College again. Suma was also from Mysore Medical College, yes. And she did a specialization in eye plastic surgery and eye cancer from the prestigious L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. And she did her eye cancer fellowship from the Wills Eye Hospital, Philadelphia, USA, considered the mecca of ocular oncology. And an eye plastic surgery training from Shiley Eye Institute, San Diego, USA. He's a recipient of various academic awards, including American Academy of Ophthalmology Achievement Award in 2015, the Asia Pacific Academy of Ophthalmology Achievement Award in 2017 for the academic excellence. And recently she was in the news for being the one among the top 100 most influential women ophthalmologists of the world. So here we have a topper among the 100 ophthalmologists of the world giving proud to present Dr. Fairuz to talk on the ophthalmic aspects of mucormycosis. Fairuz ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Asha, for this kind introduction. And it has been so enlightening listening to the previous two speakers. I'm going to share my screen now. Hope it's visible.
Yes. Right.
On that, yeah. So, well, before I start, a very good evening to everyone. And I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to IMA Malappuram, the organizers, and especially Dr. Jaleel for this kind invitation to be part of this excellent scientific program and involving an ophthalmologist and oculoplasty and orbit specialist in this. So I'm sure that you identify, it is definitely a team of doctors and a multidisciplinary team who's involved in the management of this current dilemma that we are all facing with. And this is definitely a very, very great initiative. So, this speaks everything, you know, what we are currently going through. It is an epidemic over a pandemic at this point of time where we are battling with COVID-19, finding it difficult. And then there arises like, you know, something like mucormycosis. So it's something like a mole over a mountain. Malayalathile paranjal kooninmel kuru ennu venam namukku parayam. So that is a situation that we are in. And why is this considered, and why is it so much of a concern among different specialities, as you know, Dr. Chandni really pointed it out? It is absolutely a dismal situation. It is potentially lethal. Mucormycosis is potentially lethal. It rapidly progresses compared to other fungal infection like aspergillosis or candidiasis, which is also present. We have seen many intraocular candidiasis, which is being present. We are seeing aspergillosis, but mucormycosis as such is extremely devastating. And Dr. Chandni was telling it is disfiguring in certain cases. So these are the things which is of major concern regarding mucormycosis as a specialist. We all know, we have, you know, listened in detail from the previous two speakers regarding mucorales. You know, someone actually raised the question, why is it happening, you know, in the face? So, we all know that it is ubiquitous in nature. It is there in the soil, it is there in the food, it's there in the dung, and even in the air. So it's easy for mucormycosis to be, you know, the pores to be entering through the nose, and then they might be, even with a trivial trauma to the nasal mucosa, they can actually flourish inside the nasal mucosa, especially with the immunocompromised status. We all know the risk factors of mucormycosis. I've read about it from the past. We know diabetes mellitus, organ transplant, overall immunosuppression, and steroids and immunomodulators have a role to play. And we also know the fact that COVID-19 dampens the immune system overall. So there are many things that we know, and there are far more many things that are yet unknown regarding this relationship between COVID-19 and mucormycosis. I'm just putting you certain literature, you know, kind of evidence-based. So epidemiology of mucormycosis in India, you know, so it was there. It is not a new disease, we all know, but it has been rare. So as far as, you know, this 2020 review is concerned, from 2015 to 2019, it was only 38 cases where they have seen. But alarmingly, I'm coming from Karnataka, so it is reported that in Karnataka, we have seen like 700 cases in the past 3 weeks. I have seen in the past 4 weeks, 22 cases. And even in public hospital today, I was just talking to one of my colleagues. She said they have 80 cases, which is already admitted, you know, few of them very, very bad. So this is the situation that we are facing at this point of time, where there is a rapid surge, you know, in mucormycosis. And that's exactly why we are talking about it today. We all know that patients have underlying risk factors. And another thing that we have also noticed is that it is also affecting immunocompromised competent host. But most alarming is that we always say that it's associated with diabetes, but there are patients who have been undiagnosed with diabetes mellitus. It could be a juvenile diabetes mellitus or even a type 2 diabetes mellitus, who have never undergone a blood sugar checkup, and then they are newly detected after, you know, the patient has been treated with steroids. So we all know that there are different types. It has been already discussed by Dr. Chandani. And irrespective of the fact whether it's COVID or not COVID, well, rhino-orbitocerebral mucosis has been common. So, if you ask me whether, you know, it's only in 2021 that we have seen mucormycosis, no. Even when in 2020, when COVID was a pandemic, in my practice, I have seen 4 cases of mucormycosis. So this was a literature which was published from 2 centers of oculoplasty, where they actually published 6 cases of mucormycosis. And this is one of the first publication on mucormycosis during COVID time. So as an eye oculoplastic surgeon, orbit surgeon, and an ophthalmologist, why is it so important for us? You all know that although eye is a small organ, orbit is a small compartment, there are so many vital structures in the orbit, and it's close proximity to the nose, the paranasal sinus, and also it extends into the brain. So this is kind of a, you know, very complex anatomical location where even a devastating situation, a vision-threatening complication can happen in this patient, leaving the patient with long-term disability. So that is why eye and orbit is so very important and we are so concerned about it. Nasal symptoms, Dr. Suma has already spoken about it. As an ophthalmologist, well, I'm sure we're all physicians, have learned about it, we know about it. With certain ocular symptoms, even if it is very, very faint, like a faint facial pain, one-sided headache, a facial and eyelid edema, sudden loss of vision, diplopia, ptosis, chemosis, proptosis, complete ptosis, like a complete ophthalmoplegia is like almost 100% it is mucormycosis, periocular discoloration, paresthesia, anesthesia. And these are the things that we have to actually educate the public. We have to educate them regarding all these symptoms in order to have an early diagnosis, because we all know that with early diagnosis, the outcome is, better. So in the meanwhile, this is what is happening in the oculoplasty fraternity, the orbit surgeons. So this is the recent guideline. It's still not available, but this is going to come in the June edition. And this is put forward by the editor of Indian Journal of Ophthalmology, my mentor, Dr. Santosh Honawar, because he always, is one step ahead of everything that is happening in the current scenario. So where, a code and guidelines have been set, although because we don't have a particular guidelines as far as ENT is concerned, oculoplasty or maxillofacial team is concerned. So there was an effort and initiative to do a guidelines, because we all know that in our medical practice, an organized way of dealing with the disease always helps in the betterment of and improvement of the disease. So this is a staging system which has been proposed in this particular, editorial, where we stage it into stage 1, 2, 3, and 4. So stage 1 is basically the involvement of the nasal mucosa. And it could be, again, ABC. I'm not going into detail. So this is usually diagnosed with, a nasal endoscopy, which is very, very important, and a deep nasal swab. So this was 2 days back when I was attending a webinar and, a very competent ENT surgeon, a skull-based surgeon, was presenting. And he even said that sometimes a nasal endoscope may not be able to detect, an early diagnosis. Sometimes it might be just involving the paranasal sinus without any involvement of the nose. So, well, there are so many things that we are learning from each other at this point of time. So this is exactly how a nasal endoscope looks like. And we as oculoplastic surgeons, we do nasal endoscopy as well in order to stay. Stage 2 is basically involvement of the paranasal sinuses. It could be one sinus, ipsilateral sinus, contralateral sinus. And well, this basically is diagnosed with the aid of radiology in stage 2. Now in stage 3 is, full-fledged involvement of the orbit. Orbit can be mostly medial, because we all know that, the ethmoid is, the medial wall of the orbit is mostly affected, where all the sinuses are present, and that is the easy approach for this mucormycosis to extend into the orbit, the inferior vital fissure, the pterygopalatine fossa, and this is the route of transmission. So whenever there is a diffuse orbital involvement, it comes to, again, in a higher severe degree, and if bilateral orbital involvement, as in this case, it would be 3D. So the stage 4 is, again, the severest form of rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis is the involvement of the central nervous system. So depending upon the involvement of which part of the central nervous system, again, it is staged accordingly. So this is basically the proposed staging system, although there are many institutes which has come up with the scoring system, relating to the orbital inflammation that the patient is having, but nothing has been steadfast and confirmed as a guideline so far. Now, a diagnosis, Dr. Suma was telling, quick and rapid in everything that she was mentioning about everything. So this is what is very, very important. It has to be a rapid diagnosis clinically. And ocular examination has to be in detail, involving the periocular area. You look for proptosis, the anterior segment, the pupil is very, very important. You get to know whether the orbital apex is involved or not. A fundus evaluation, a detailed fundus evaluation is important, because being an angioinvasive disease and causing thrombosis of the vessel, some of these patients presents with central retinal artery occlusion as well. And all these things actually help you to take a right decision, you know, in the appropriate management of these patients. So in nasal endoscopy, it is suggested that we take a deep nasal swab. And as Dr. Suma already mentioned, and we also very strongly believe, is that histopathology, a biopsy, you know, a biopsy is always superior to any of the other procedures as far as diagnosis is concerned. Now, in biopsy, again, histopathology, I would just like to mention over here, which I've mentioned right here, something which is really, really rapid. You know, culture takes time. So we need something which can provide diagnosis, essentially confirm diagnosis really, really quick. So we would go for a squash or an imprint cytology, or even take a biopsy and send it for a frozen section. Frozen section results are available within 15 to 20 minutes. So this is with the rapidity that we go ahead with the diagnosis of this disease. And well, imaging is very, very important. CT scan has a role. MRI with contrast is definitely preferable, but there are certain challenges that we face in our regular practice. Although, you know, we want to do the best for the patient, but we come up with so many challenges. Sometimes you're not able to do MRI in patient, and of course microbiology with 10% KOH is the diagnosis. So I'll just quickly touch upon the radiology or in mucormycosis in the current scenario. Well, as I told you, MRI with contrast is the preferable imaging modality in the diagnosis of rhinocerebral, rhinoorbital mucormycosis. It has definitive signs. This is called the black turbinate sign. And this appears black. Why? Because, you know, there is thrombosis and there is no uptake of the contrast, and it has to be contrast enhanced. So, you know, it's very easy to talk about what is best for the patient, but we do face certain challenges, especially when the systemic status of the patient is very, very poor. MRI is time consuming, CT scan is quick. Another thing that we have, you know, lately come across is like the renal function. And most of these patients, as we all know, majority of the patients, these are the practical problems, have diabetes mellitus, which is uncontrolled, and most of them have a very bad renal function. So again, giving them a contrast and doing an MRI has become challenging at certain situation when, of course, CT scan is also good. So that's when, you know, we really prefer CT scan. But MRI, no doubt, you know, it gives you the, delineates the soft tissue, the optic nerve, the apex, the cavernous sinus, intracranial extension, and also, you know, how much of necrosis and thrombosis is happening with the contrast. So that is about the imaging, and that's overall regarding the diagnosis. And again, I would stress it has to be really, really rapid. Now, management, most importantly, so this is where a team of specialists plays a role, and someone who really controls the team is the endocrinologist and the intensive care specialist. So the strict metabolic control is very, very important. I don't have to stress about it. As physicians, we all know. So going on to the management, again, it's, you know, three ways of managing it: systemic management, well, of course, strict metabolic control. Apart from that, antifungals, injection liposomal amphotericin B, which we all know, I'm not going into the detail of it. Even anticoagulants has a role at some point of time in the management of mucormycosis. Surgery, of course, is very, very important, debridement. In fact, you know, to be very honest here, if it is an early diagnosis, if the patient is coming very, very early, I refer most of my case to the ENT specialist and kind of shy away from anything which is debilitating or, you know, surgical excentration or whatsoever. So ENT specialist really, really plays a major role in aggressive debridement of the paranasal sinus and the diseased tissue. Then comes orbital excentration. We are going to discuss about it in detail later. Now, we do have certain local conservative measures you know, as oculoplastic orbit surgeons, we also consider orbital injection of antifungals locally. And in fact, we also recommend sinus irrigation with antifungals when debridement is happening. So this is a very interesting review. Now, this is basically an overall management, view of the management of mucormycosis. And in this 929 reported cases, what they have found was, you know, regarding the survival, I'm just going to have just highlighted with the red line over here, but this is exactly what the basic conclusion of this paper is from the 929 reported cases. Regarding the survival, with no treatment, the survival is 3%. All right, 97% of the patients died. With amphotericin B, 61% survival. Surgery, 57%. And combined antifungal and surgery, it is 70%. So definitely surgery has a role. And that's something that I wanted to really, really stress upon here. So I'll take you through a few cases like how we managed. So this is a 58-year-old lady who came with a total loss of vision. In fact, you know, she was not bothered about her swelling. There is definitely swelling in and around, some amount of pain and total loss of vision. And that's how she came into the, you know, the center. So what we did was, as you can see here, there is extensive sinus involvement. She also had frontal sinus involvement. All the sinuses were involved. And in fact, in her orbit, if you see, it's basically the apical area which is involved. Dr. Suma was talking about it. If it is apex, you know, it is an indication of excentration. Well, you know, by managing few cases over the time, we really don't jump into excentration, even in these cases where there is very minimal involvement, although it is apex. And she also has cavernous sinus involvement in this patient. So we held on to it. We made sure that her glycemic control is absolutely under control. She underwent FES, amphotericin B was given to her, and which was followed by posaconazole, which she continued for 6 months, and she's still alive after 6 months. And this is actually a patient that I saw in the first wave of COVID. So there can be patients who absolutely presents with no inflammatory signs. You know, it is, this indicates that with a total ophthalmoplegia and a white eye, something is brewing in the apex of the orbit. Well, you know, the orbit is not totally involved. And as in this, this is where, you know, the apical portion of the orbit was involved. And that patient is also treated conservatively. No excentration was done. Now, you might be wondering, you know, that's something that I have put forward. Is the intraorbital injection of amphotericin B. Well, there are no specific indications and there is no, you know, prospective randomized controlled trials or studies which has been conducted. There are isolated case reports and case series where it has been used, and we have started it, using it now. The dosage that we usually give is 3.5 milligram per ml of liposomal amphotericin B, preferably that, because and the other amphotericin B, the inflammatory signs are much higher in the orbit after injection. Now, indication, of course, it is eye preserving and it is given post debridement. I prefer it if there is an orbital apex involvement, you know, where the fungus can extend intracranially. So every 2 weeks, this injection is preferred. If there is isolated muscle involvement, you can just go inside the orbit and inject it. Side effects, well, it is an off-label use. Reported side effects, if with liposomal amphotericin B, it's not too bad. You might have a little bit of chemosis, which is persisting for week or so. But with the amphotericin, otherwise, you can anticipate is the orbital compartment syndrome, which can cause, you know, secondary to the inflammation in the orbit. So, well, neurotoxicity is a concern as far as intraorbital injection of amphotericin B, but there is no absolute proof regarding this. So there are so many ifs and buts in this as well. So this is a patient again with, you know, chemosis, and as you can see here, periocular swelling, where there is involvement of the sinus and the medial where an intraorbital amphotericin B was made. So this was a 14-year-old patient who was unknown juvenile diabetes mellitus, who initially presented with mucormycosis with rapid progression. She was febrile. She had altered sensorium where already it has extended into the brain, and it has involved the entire, you know, right half of her face. So this, what we found in the brain MRI was like she had an abscess in the brain, multiple abscesses. In fact, this is one of it where you can see. But although she was not systemically doing fine, you know, the only option that we had in such an extensive disease where there is a chance of losing this child, went ahead, did an extensive debridement, excentration, et cetera, along with the maxillofacial team and the ENT team. Well, you know, it's been, I would say, 6 months, more than 6 months, and she is alive with all these things, despite the fact that she had a cerebral abscess. So indication of orbital excentration in mucormycosis, this is something that I would like to highlight over here. So in this, a literature review from 113 articles where the OPRS, which is the American Society of Oculoplasty and Refractive Surgeons, found that was the frontal sinus involvement and fever were less likely to survive. So there are certain things that they had kind of, you know, put into a basket and said these are the poor prognosis. So excentrated patients with fever were more likely to survive compared with non-excentrated patients with fever. So fever is something which is considered as a bad prognosis when the patient presents with mucormycosis. Well, then, you know, you would want to go ahead and think of doing excentration in this patient. But the fact is, there is no standard of care currently which really exists to guide a physician, you know, when to excentrate or not. But, you know, in our clinical practice, we do consider when there is a diffuse orbital involvement and there is worsening, you know, or no improvement of the symptoms even after 72 hours, and severe disease with no useful vision. This is when we actually think of orbital excentration. Orbital excentration as an oculoplastic surgeon, well, we all know that it is disfiguring, it is devastating, it is psychologically devastating for the patient. As an oculoplastic surgeon, we would also, back of our mind, consider something which is more, you know, presentable for these patients. So we often consider a lid sparing excentration. We do not leave the socket empty for, you know, spontaneous granulation. We do a lid sparing excentration where in and around the eye, we try to spare the periocular skin so that we cover the entire socket. But there are situations where there is extensive necrosis where you absolutely will not be able to spare any periocular tissue around. Now, as far as these patients are considered, we as oculoplastic surgeons definitely agree that orbital excentration is a disfiguring procedure, but then there is always a risk versus benefits. And we all agree that life is more important than anything else in these patients. So rehabilitation also is very important because it psychologically devastates the patient. And now we can see there are so many young patients who are coming up with mucormycosis, and there's so many years in their life where they have to be productive, you know, and the quality of life is so very important. So this is exactly how the lid sparing excentration looks like, where we cover the entire socket with the periocular skin, and we do consider in all patients to give them prosthesis because we have excellent ocularistry team who does this for patients in various parts of India. This is basically a review of all these series of cases which has been reported of rhino-orbital mucormycosis associated with COVID-19, with steroid, without steroid. Well, excentration is not done too frequently. There are limited indications for excentration, whereas in all patients, unanimously, a fess and a sinus debridement is the treatment of choice. And life salvage, as you can see here, there are series where they could actually salvage almost all the patient's life, but well, there are unfortunate cases as well. And someone was asking whether, you know, what kind is usually detected in mucormycosis. It is still the most common second one is Rhizopus from the Review of Literature, and very, very, very rarely the Epsidia species. It's just one over here in the entire review. So this is regarding, in a nutshell, in this limited time, regarding the disease, the diagnosis, the management. Now, we do have challenges. We all know that. So we were in a very dire situation here. Even as a practitioner, you know, we were running in and around looking for antifungals where absolute unavailability, and there was acute shortage of antifungals. We are getting slightly better now. Still, the situation is not good. Systemic condition of the patients, which actually increases the anesthetic risk for surgical intervention. And most important is, you know, we should avoid late diagnosis. One is raise the public awareness, talk to everyone possible, you know, as physicians, raise the awareness among the public. And another thing that we are facing, obviously, because of the lockdown, you know, the rapid referral to the higher center, it's taking time. If someone sends you a picture that this is how it is, then you tell them, come on, come to the, you know, a center where there is a multidisciplinary team, and these are the things that we need to do. But then it really takes time for the patient from an interior location to come to a higher center. So that is one of the challenges that we are facing. Early diagnosis, I would stress. And well, there are so many things which is still not known. You know, people were asking Dr. Chandani whether this is the cause, that is the cause. We are still getting to know the causes, because it's so important to know that so that we avoid those causes in order to prevent this bad disease, the lethal, devastating disease. I personally believe that prevention is really, really better than cure, as you know, the old saying goes. So it is so very important to control the blood sugar of these patients. Again, as physicians, raise this awareness and absolutely, you know, make sure from a physician point of view that judicious use of steroids, because we have come across patients who have presented with mucormycosis, and this is the practical issue. Right from day one, these patients are started, even for a mild disease, they are started on steroids by a family physician, which is absolute no-no. So even when you start the patient on steroid, I think in this scenario, it's so very important to assess their blood sugar even before starting immunosuppressive. We as Indians doesn't have, you know, a lifestyle where we do a complete body checkup or blood checkup every year to know what is actually happening wrong with us. Most of these patients are undiagnosed diabetes mellitus. And this is where, you know, you see patients who are not diabetes but still getting mucormycosis. So it's so very important as far as physicians, us, you know, as a team of people are concerned. And yes, proper hygiene and sanitation, whether it be a healthcare, you know, personal hygiene, use of clean mask. And these are very, very general things to talk about. So, well, we are battling this together. And I think, you know, we are getting there, we're getting better. And hopefully future will be better in battling this mucormycosis. Thank you for your patient listening. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr.
I'm just going to stop my share.
You can't stop here? Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for that very wonderful talk. Ophthal is an area which generally doesn't come in most CMEs. That is an area where people listen with sharp ears, with all areas beyond the routine discussion.
I think most of the people doesn't even recognize oculoplasty and orbit even as a specialty, you know. Even among general physicians, some people ask me, oh, there is a specialty like that. Yes, we do a lot of orbital work, yeah.
Okay. Can we have the questions? I think there's one, either you or Suma can answer. What are the indications for re-imaging post-surgery in ROCM?
See, re-imaging, Fairuz, you want to take?
Ma'am, go ahead. I will give my bit of thing. You go ahead.
Contribute. There needn't be any formality. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Start off.
The re-imaging, what we usually do is we initial MRI with contrast will give you a rough estimation of where all the disease has spread. And usually, if you have done a devitalization, all the devitalized tissue has removed, then we go ahead with a repeat endoscopic assessment. And if the patient is getting normalized ESR and CRP, and the endoscopy picture is giving a better view that the all the you can see the normal mucosalization of the sinuses, and then the patient is symptomatically better. Then we do imaging only later. Otherwise, we may take up the patient for contrast study again, and MRI with contrast will be better for post imaging, but may not be possible, as Fairuz said, may not be possible in all the centers. But we do. Otherwise, we don't do a immediate re-imaging again if the patient is better and symptomatically he is, and the ESR and CRP are normalized. We continue them on posaconazole for a minimum of 3 to 6 months, and then take a after 6 weeks we do a imaging again. Not immediately.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, in similar lines, yes, ma'am. Yeah. So, if the patient, if the patient comes back with a little bit of swelling or periocular, it's basically symptomatic when I take an decision on re-imaging the patient. If the patient comes and tells there is a facial pain, I don't ignore it. I take it seriously, and whether it is 3 months or 4 months post, you know, completion of treatment, I would go ahead with an imaging. But if the patient is symptomatically fine, nasal endoscopy is good, then, well, I would wait for it. But any faint symptoms, sometimes it can be a psychological thing from a patient. You know, she just comes and tells me that there is a slight pain. But I wouldn't shy away from doing an MRI if patient is symptomatic, yeah. Be it 3 months or 4 months.
Thank you. Mucormycosis can also be considered as a post-COVID syndrome? And can it be considered as a post-COVID syndrome? And if so, how many days after the initial infection do you usually expect?
See, the number of cases Fairuz has must be much more than what Kerala has. But here we do get in post-COVID and also in patients with COVID positive, RAT positive cases. So there is some amount of immunosuppression going on with COVID patients, which is a strong indication, a strong reason for them to get opportunistic infection. And more than that, many factors we have already discussed, steroid, immunomodulating drugs, uncontrolled diabetes. Uncontrolled diabetes is a major risk factor as far as India is concerned. So all these together will be, we don't know how many more are there to contribute to this pandemic. To this epidemic of mucormycosis.
I think to be very specific, the known factors, of course, as you mentioned, ma'am, diabetes and immunosuppressants, even the use of tocilizumab as an immunomodulator, there are many, many literature indicating that it could be a cause for this, you know, existence of both together. And voriconazole, the use of voriconazole, it's been used left and right. So these are the things that we have to rewind and think, you know, modifications that we have to do in our practice. Yeah.
A specific question to Fairuz ma'am from Srivansan sir. What is the orbital compartment syndrome?
All right. Yeah, hi, sir. So orbital compartment syndrome is where there is a severe inflammation in the orbit, and there is swelling of all the tissues in the orbit, the soft tissues, including the fat, the muscles. And then it becomes a very, very tight compartment, which can lead to increase in the intraocular pressure, severe pain and tightness in the orbit. So there are situations in the presence of orbital compartment syndrome, we might have to even release the pressure. We might have to do a lateral canthotomy and kind of release the pressure. So it's basically a pressure building up in the orbit due to severe inflammation. That is what orbital compartment syndrome is. What is the percentage of orbital prostheses?
In your center, yeah.
Percentage, I didn't understand, Dr. Srivansan.
I suppose after excentration, the prostheses, number of...
Every patient after excentration, we advise prostheses. Because quality of life, you know, doctor, when Dr. Chandini said it's disfiguring, it really pricked me, yes. And it's very, very true. Especially these young patients, you know, who are working, you know, it's psychologically devastates them. Every patient, whether it's excentration due to mucormycosis, I do a lot of ocular oncology where we might land up with, you know, excentrating orbital tumors and stuff. So every patient is advised excentration prostheses. Yeah.
And even for maxilla, though we don't plan for a definitive treatment, definitive reconstructive procedure, the interim prosthesis we give. Otherwise, they can't eat properly. They'll have an oroanterial fistula, large problems related to that. They have to be in Ryle's tube. So we give a prosthesis for the interim period, and then we plan for a reconstructive surgery later. Proper surgery later.
Ma'am?
Okay. Is the unilateral ophthalmoplegia purely due to cavernous sinus thrombosis an indication for TRAMD?
What is TRAMD, TRAMP? What is TRAMD? I'm sorry, I don't know.
It was a question by some MM, maybe I don't know who.
Yeah, ma'am, Suma ma'am, you know what is TRAMD? I'm so sorry.
Retrobulbar amphotericin?
Okay, maybe retrobulbar amphotericin.
But that doesn't sound.
I don't.
No, I'm not
TRA.
Sure.
Okay, I didn't see that.
Trans retro. Well, I don't know what TRAMD is.
Person who put the question in the.
Those who put the question in the chat box can ask directly, I think.
That's what I'm asking.
We cannot try the abbreviations here.
Okay. Talkalam vida. Talkalam question namku vida. And is there any incidence of mucormycosis in those who have taken both doses of vaccine?
No, I don't have in my series. No.
Even we haven't got those both.
Reassuring,
definitely.
May I ask someone question to Dr. Suma?
Yeah.
I had put it in chat box. What are the common cranial nerves which are involved in this disease? What is the importance of black turbinate cyst?
Okay. Common 3, 4, 6, definitely. And you may get a numbness of the fifth nerve also may be involved. But we had patients presenting with facial palsy. And the lady that I have shown had all cranial nerves except perhaps 1, 8, 11. All cranial nerves were involved. So it is like it's an angioinvasive disease. You can any presentation can be possible in patients like this. So definitely the early symptoms will be early cranial nerves involved will be usually 3, 4, 6 with the ophthalmoplegia. And later they can have, and there are presentations that we had, I think one patient is still there with facial nerve palsy. And the previous series also we had patients presenting with facial palsy. So it's possible.
And black turbinate sign.
Black turbinate sign is, plaque, the turbinate is the one site where the initial lesion will be present. Because it's an the mucosa will become avascular, and initially you don't see anything. If you get a very early case, what you see is just pallor of the mucosa and decreased bleeding on abrasion. So in that stage, you have to pick them up. You take a biopsy from the turbinate. And what is black turbinate? Black turbinate is you compare you when you give a contrast. In T1 contrast, when you the others look at the other side of the turbinate, the turbinate on the other side will be hyper intense or enhancing, where this turbinate will have loss of enhancement. The loss of enhancement is very characteristic of mucormycosis because of its angioinvasion. Loss of enhancement is very suggestive, and you should look for where all areas the loss of enhancement is there. Any focal, it need not be always contiguous. You can get pterygopalatine fossa, one loss of enhancement, then infraorbital or inferior orbital fissure area. So it can be a non-contiguous type of loss of enhancement. So all those area, particular care should be taken, and the loss of enhancement may be behind an intact bone. So the posterior wall of maxilla may appear perfectly normal, but when the posterior wall is removed, you can see disease in the pterygopalatine fossa, infratemporal fossa, the muscles are involved. So it is, you have to study the MRI very properly, and wherever the disease is there, that has to be debrided or removed.
Thank you.
Dr. Asha, someone has typed actually transcutaneous retrobulbar amputation via. So as an orbit specialist, we don't do transcutaneous. We go through the medial canthal area, through the caruncle and the conjunctiva. So we don't go through the skin, in fact, medially. So that's how we inject amputation via. So the question was, it's unilateral.
Purely due to cavernous sinus thrombosis.
No. So it is an antifungal thing. So if there is a component of the disease in the orbit, that's when we would want to go ahead and inject into the orbit. So anticoagulants are also indicated in certain scenarios where there is cavernous sinus thrombosis. So that holds more weightage than this. Yeah.
And how is your results following intraorbital amphotericin? Because we had tried in many, I don't know for sure to say that it is useful, because those were late cases, so I don't know for sure.
Yeah, so this is a kind of, a situation where we don't want to go for exaggeration. A desperate situation, yeah. So we are looking into the data. In fact, the Oculoplasty Society of India is collecting huge data. So probably after the data, we would be able to actually, comment from a huge study that whether it is really helpful or not. But then we are going ahead and giving it, if at all it helps.
Because we always try to postpone it as much as possible. It's really a difficult decision to take, whether to accentuate or not.
Injection. It's not too difficult, even if the patient is not systemically, stable to go for the intervention. Well, something is there as a tool or weapon in your hand to take care of the situation. Yeah.
Initial stages, the symptoms mimic that of pseudo tumor, and how do you differentiate between the two initial stages?
A very good question. Yes, so in this situation where we all know that COVID and mucormycosis is coexisting together, we would definitely go ahead and, as an ENT surgeon, Dr. Suma, it's not too difficult to go into the sinus and take a biopsy. So we would confirm it with biopsy and then go ahead with the management. In fact, I had a patient who was referred as a case of mucormycosis. He was diabetic, during the COVID time, and it was not really fitting into mucormycosis. So I had to just go in and take an incision biopsy because the upper portion of the orbit was filled, although the sinuses were clean, and it was rapidly progressing like a mucormycosis, So it came out to be a natural killer T cell lymphoma of the orbit. So, well, these are the things with your clinical, kind of a judgment that you have to go ahead. Yeah. And biopsy is always the best to confirm the diagnosis. Yeah,
this is T cell lymphoma of the nasal cavity, also usually present like this. A very difficult, very challenging situation. Yeah. We had a patient with chronic liver disease, similar situation. Mm-hmm. The biopsy proved that.
Yeah. So tumor steroids will be the starting treatment, right? So then you got to differentiate before you start.
That's what you have to. Yeah. And it responds so very well.
What is the initial presentation in ophthalmic? What is the sequence of investigations? When the initial presentation is ophthalmic, what is the sequence of investigation? Yes.
Well, so first and foremost, we have to evaluate with nasal endoscopy. One, just make sure that everything is fine locally, which can be done in a clinic. And then MRI with contrast is preferable modality to go ahead with to confirm, whether there is any sinus involvement, whether it's the apex which is involved. So that is how we would go ahead with the management. And then if we have to confirm, especially in those patients, I have not done too many excentration. Luckily, we have tried to conserve it as much as possible, although the eye is blind. If at all you're going for exenteration, you have to have a proof of tissue biopsy that it is mucormycosis legally. So it's so very important to have a tissue diagnosis. Well, yeah.
Dr. Soma?
Yes, sir. Ah, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening, good evening.
A nice presentation.
Thank you.
In your experience, what's the minimum period of COVID positivity and development of symptoms?
I can't say, sir. The one patient had a 1 month following post-COVID, one episode of COVID, and he became COVID again.
That's the patient which we sent, isn't it?
That's what,
right.
Positive. Same patient. He is RAT positive now. So we don't know how long the problem persists and whether it is only in post-COVID. We are getting it in COVID patients also. So this we need to have to look at the data worldwide, the nationwide, and find out what is the predisposing factors, whether it's only in post-COVID. Definitely not only in post-COVID, but what is the time duration and whether COVID patients are also having the same. And we have to look into the data, whether how many of them are vaccinated, two doses. All these are data to be checked.
Yeah.
We can't say for sure now.
Okay, thank you.
That patient is okay now, but
He is calling every day, 3-4 times. But
they are happy, yeah.
Yeah. That nasal endoscopy really surprised me, because the whole period of time, you know, it was only 1 week. The first MRI didn't show anything. But when they reported to us, there was a minimal ophthalmoparesis. So that made us to have the red light. And then we did a nasal endoscopy. And the whole nasal cavity was filled with the avascular tissue.
It's like the entire mucosa is left out.
Yeah.
And the pterygoid wedge, all looking like an osteomyelitic bone. Pterygoid wedge, the perpendicular plate of ethmoid, perpendicular plate of palatine bone. All were coming out like...
But because the lesion was just peeping into the brain through the cribriform plate, isn't it?
The parenchyma involves.
Yeah. So you had removed that also?
Because we had to plan for reconstruction also. So that we'll do it at a later date. The complete cribriform plate has to be removed. And now you can't reconstruct properly unless you remove the entire that brain parenchyma. So we had to
sit. Orbit was also involved, isn't it?
Orbit extensively involved. We debrided all, I think, almost completely. Now we have to see, since the patient is also having intracranial compartment, we have to see the response. He's okay now, but
okay. Let's cross our fingers and pray, isn't it?
Yes.
Anyway, congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Feroz ma'am, another question to you. The dosage and quantity of retrobulbar amphotericin, is the dose same as for liposomal amphotericin?
Yeah, so it is basically 3.5 ml that we inject, 3.5 milligram of injection amphotericin B. Yeah.
The cause of blindness in mucormycosis other than cranial nerve palsy?
Cranial nerve palsy is not a cause of blindness. It is not a cause of blindness. So the cause of blindness in mucormycosis is mainly central retinal artery occlusion, being an angioinvasive disease, and there is thrombosis of the vessel and then they go blind. And if the orbital apex is involved, we call it orbital apex syndrome, where they come with complete ophthalmoplegia, where the optic canal is anatomically affected, the superior orbital fissure is affected. So these are the areas where all the nerves, the vessels, everything is entering the orbit. So if the apex of the orbit is involved because of the central retinal artery occlusion, they go for blindness.
The approximate time of progression of the disease from the initial stage to a fatal excentration, the expected time?
Well, you know, there is no hard and fast rule that every patient is following the same thing. You know, there was a patient who was advised MRI, COVID-19 positive patient, admitted young patient, 45-year-old, advised MRI, didn't get back, checked, she's no more. So that was within 3 days, you know, but then there are patients who really take it forward even after exenteration, like the small child that I showed. She had even a cerebral abscess, but then she recovered. So there is nothing like, you know, this is going to do bad, and probably the infectivity, the metabolic control of the body, all these things plays a role. Many factors, in fact, yeah.
And most important definitely is the immune status of the patient. And if they can have a better control of diabetes or whatever be the immunosuppressed condition, that itself is an early treatment.
Yes.
Dr. Fairuza?
Yes, sir.
Excellent talk.
Thank you very much, sir.
I had seen a case 3 years back.
Okay.
A patient who had CKD going for... who had gone blind in both eyes.
Okay.
Is it because the chiasma is affected or separate lesion usually?
So because of mucormycosis.
Yeah. It was mucormycosis. We lost the patient later on.
Okay, so usually the loss of vision, it's because not of the nerve, because we all know mucormycosis is an angioinvasive disease. It's mostly vascular, you know, they go for a CRAO, a cavernous sinus thrombosis, and then they lose the vision. Nothing to do with chiasm, you know, nothing to do with the neurological pathology, in fact.
Loss of vascularity, which where actually?
The central retinal artery occlusion, sir. The thrombus, and that's the most common cause for loss of vision in these patients.
Okay, thank you.
There's a question to Suma. The young patient that you showed was immunocompromised?
Yeah, diabetes, juvenile diabetes.
Has anyone seen any immunocompetent patient with?
We have zygomycetes or mucorales of known as apophysomyces elegans. Apophysomyces elegans is usually seen in immunocompetent individuals. And one of our patients was immunocompetent, actually, not diabetic. He is COVID positive and he had a course of steroid as a treatment for orbital cellulitis. The young patient I saw with the blackish necrosis of the skin, that charted as orbital cellulitis and treated with steroids, that is the only immunocompromise he has with COVID positive. We don't know how much COVID makes the people immunosuppressed.
I had shown that literature of epidemiology of mucormycosis. It's a known fact that it can happen in immunocompetent patients also, but majority is in immunocompromised.
It's more than 2 hours now. It is not unfair to prolong the speakers more than that, I suppose. What do you say? Shall we wind up the questions for now? Questions keep coming, that is a fact. But then you got to interfere somewhere along the way.
Hi, Fairuz.
Hi, ma'am. How are you? Nice to meet you. I'm fine. Nice. Yeah. Familiar faces for me, so I'm happy.
That is why I sent the message to you yesterday.
Yes. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
So shall we temporarily come to the conclusion of the question answer session?
Yeah.
If more questions are there, we'll direct it straight, direct personally to the speakers, then if more come into the group. Otherwise, it will be too exhausting.
Yeah.
So a formal thank you will be by Nilar sir, I suppose. But personally, I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Dr. Jalal. Jalal?
Yes, sir.
Vote of thanks. Finally, I come to the vote of thanks.
Why the PM, sir?
Yeah. Other. Good evening. Vote of thanks, Jalal.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. നമ്മളുടെ ഇന്നത്തെ ഈ ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് കമ്മിറ്റിയുടെ നേതൃത്വത്തിലുള്ള ഈ വെബിനാറില് ആദ്യം മുതൽ അവസാനം വരെ പങ്കെടുത്ത എല്ലാ ആൾക്കാർക്കും ഞാൻ ആദ്യമായി നന്ദി പറയുകയാണ്. അതേപോലെ തന്നെ നമ്മളുടെ നമ്മളെ ഈ മ്യൂക്കർ മൈക്കോസ് എന്നുള്ള ടോപ്പിക് തന്നെ നമ്മളുടെ ഇതില് സെലക്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ കാരണം തന്നെ ഒന്നാമത് നമ്മളുടെ ഈ ഡോക്ടേഴ്സിന്റെ ഇടയിൽ തന്നെയുള്ള പല ഡൗട്ട്സുകളും നമുക്ക് ഇതിലെ ഈ എക്സലന്റ് പ്രസന്റേഷൻസിലൂടെ നമുക്ക് ക്ലിയർ ചെയ്യാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞു. അതിന് നമ്മളുടെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഇവിടെ എത്തിയ ചാന്ദ്രി മാഡം, അതേപോലെ തന്നെ സുമ മാഡം, അതേപോലെ തന്നെ ഫൈറോസ് മാഡം, ഞാന് ജസ്റ്റ് ഒന്ന് റിക്വസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്ത സമയത്ത് തന്നെ എല്ലാ ആൾക്കാരും വിത്തൌട്ട് എനി ഒരു ഇതില്ലാണ്ട് തന്നെ നമ്മുടെ മലപ്പുറം നമ്മളുടെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഇവിടെ എത്തി. ഏകദേശം ഒരു 2 hours വളരെ കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് ആയിട്ട് നമ്മളുടെ ഈ ഇതിൽ പങ്കെടുത്ത 3 speakers സുമ മാഡം, അതേപോലെ തന്നെ ഫൈറൂസ് മാഡം, അതേപോലെ തന്നെ ചാന്ദിനി മാഡം, എല്ലാവർക്കും IMA ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് കമ്മിറ്റിയുടെ പേരിൽ ഞാൻ ഹാർദവമായ നന്ദി ആശംസിക്കുകയാണ്. അതേപോലെ തന്നെ ഇന്ന് നമ്മളുടെ ഇനീഷ്യൽ നമ്മളുടെ ഈ ഇതിൽ ആൾക്കാരുടെ ഒരു ഒരു ഇതുകൊണ്ട് നമുക്ക് ഓൾറെഡി ഒരു 300 നമ്മളുടെ സൂം ലിമിറ്റ് തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ക്രോസ് ചെയ്തു. അതുകൊണ്ട് പല ആൾക്കാരും എനിക്ക് ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് ഐ ഹാവ് റിസീവ്ഡ് അറൌണ്ട് 20-25 മെസ്സേജസ് ഇൻ മൈ ഫോൺ, സം ആർ കോളിംഗ് മീ. ഏതായാലും വളരെ ഒരു എഫക്റ്റീവ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ടോക്ക് ആയിരുന്നു. എന്തായാലും ഇതിന്റെ ലിങ്ക് എല്ലാ ഗ്രൂപ്പുകളിലും നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഡേ തന്നെ ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ഷെയർ ചെയ്യുന്നതായിരിക്കും. ഇത് നമ്മളുടെ ഈ മീറ്റിംഗോടെ അവസാനിപ്പിക്കുകയാണ്. എല്ലാവർക്കും ഒറ്റ വാക്കിൽ നമ്മുടെ മലപ്പുറം ജില്ലയിൽ നിന്ന് പുറത്ത് തന്നെ പല സീനിയർ IMA ലീഡേഴ്സ്, അതേപോലെ തന്നെ പല ആൾക്കാരും ഇതിൽ ജോയിൻ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്, എല്ലാ ആൾക്കാർക്കും ഒറ്റ വാക്കിൽ നന്ദി പറഞ്ഞുകൊണ്ട് നമ്മുടെ ആതിഥ്യം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഇവിടെ എത്തിയ എല്ലാ ആൾക്കാർക്കും ഒറ്റ വാക്കിൽ നന്ദി പറഞ്ഞുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ നിർത്തുന്നു. ജയ് ഹിന്ദ്, ജയ് IMA. നമ്മുടെ PC ചെയർമാൻ
അടുത്ത നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഫ്രൈഡേ അറ്റ് ദ സെയിം ടൈം 7:30 വിൽ ഹാവ് അനദർ മീറ്റിംഗ് ഓൺ ഓക്സിജൻ തെറാപ്പി നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഫ്രൈഡേ ഇൻ അസോസിയേഷൻ വിത്ത് ഇന്ത്യൻ സൊസൈറ്റി ഓഫ് അനസ്തീസിയോളജിസ്റ്റ്. സോ വി വെൽക്കം ഓൺ ബിഹാഫ് ഓഫ് ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് കമ്മിറ്റി വെൽക്കം യു ഓൾ ടു ദ മീറ്റിംഗ് ഓൺ ഫ്രൈഡേ അറ്റ് 7:30 വിത്ത് അനദർ ടോപ്പിക് ഓൺ ഓക്സിജൻ തെറാപ്പി. താങ്ക് യു. All. Thank you, all the speakers.
Thank you.
Thank you, all the participants. Thank you. Thank you, the moderator, Asha Vairya.
Good night, Suma.
Good night.
Such an energetic and enthusiastic team from Malappuram. So happy. Yeah. Thank you.
You contributed. You improved the enthusiasm. It was an energetic show. Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Bye. Good night.
Good night, bye. Everyone.
Bye.
Thank you, Suma, madam. Thank you, Fairos, madam.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jalal. Bye.
Good night. Good night, everybody.
Good night, sir. Good night, sir.
See you next Friday.
Okay.